My dear brothers and sisters, we have assembled here for a great event. In this beautiful place, I think you will definitely enjoy where it is surrounded by nature. So during this program, you will have idea about your nature with respect to this. So we will have an idea about Aya, how he had came into this, how he acquired this knowledge. Aya had born late 40s in a place called Tiruchendur, near Tiruchendur, in a tiny village. It is something like 400 kilometers southeast from this place. He had grown up like any normal mischievous boy. There was nothing special about him. He studied schooling there in that place. Then he went to hostel for his further studies like degree. After completing this degree, he moved to Chennai for doing his law. During this period, he got interest as to serve the people, something to do for serving the people. That was his idea. So he started reading the book accordingly. Then he came across for these philosophers and philosophical spiritual books, etc. Then he started reading J.K. Ramanar, Nisargadatta, all these kind of books he started reading. Aya is that kind of person. Okay, before that, we call him as Sri Bhagavat Aya. I think I'll give an idea about it. Aya is a word in Tamil as Sir, which is a other people use it. So it is Sir. Bhagavat is name given to him at birth. He was given by the parents. During that time, it is surprising that he is a deep South Indian and getting a name like Bhagavat. Everybody gets surprised. So during that time of independence period, Bhagavat is one of the person who is in north upper area who fought for the independence very severely. So at that time he was prominent known person throughout the country. So his parents gave him a name as Bhagavat. So after getting into this enlightenment area, people have named him as Sri Bhagavat. And we call him as Aya, so he's fully known as Sri Bhagavat Aya. So after getting into college life for degree, he started interest on reading these books of Ramana, etc. He also started developing interest on meditations parallel. But he is that kind of natured person. Unless he gets an answer for his queries, he will not further proceed. This is a very special quality of him. That means he starts, if somebody advises to approach him, he reads that. Unless he gets an answer for his question, he stops it. That means the road is blocked for him. This is one of the important characteristics of him. So then after reading so many things, then he starts practicing meditation also because of the advice from so many people. When he is doing a meditation, hoping that he will get some solution like enlightenment, but rather he was finding a problem than the solution, meaning which he started getting a health problem, which he was not able to come out so very easily. Despite of he approached doctors, he was not able to come out. Then he understood maybe this meditation was giving a problem, but it is not giving a solution to his need. Then he got stuck in that road. So he started analyzing more and more with the theory portion of it, how we can get an enlightenment. So he met another guru like one Teni Swamigal was there. His son, he discussed with him very much, many number of days to get an idea. He has spent a lot of time with him in person, 1:1. Teni Swamigal was a farmer. He was living in a deep village where the houses are not surrounded. It was in a deep field. But he could spend a lot of time with him, and Teni Swamigal also gave a lot of time. Then subsequently he got enlightened. Then he found that, okay, during this period, some 40 years had gone, where he had started his thinking, say, right from his college period. Then by that time, he got the full result. Some 40 years has passed through. Then after getting the result, it was surprised to him. It is so simple. Why I should have taken that much of difficulty? So then he thought, why not I give it this knowledge to all the people? Okay. So having decided, he felt that I got it, I should give the things free of cost to the people. Okay. Even as on today, he is giving free of cost. See, he was living. Meanwhile, he got the degree of lawyer. He was practicing a lawyer. He got married, he had a child. All normal life was there. Plus, this was there. That means spiritual activities there. So he was still continuing to live in that area by practicing the lawyer. But he wanted to give this knowledge to others. So that means there is a gap of how do you shift this knowledge to others. So obviously, now the present technology is there, IT, YouTube, Facebook, etc. Those periods, it was not there. Okay. Primarily, it was a book form, it was getting communicated. So he started making a book. Mostly the first book kind of thing was released by his handwritten paper copy, which Xerox copy was taken for circulation. That is how started moving around. People started getting the concept. After, when they had picked up, then it came as a book form. Okay? So after getting into the book form, people started getting this idea. Once people here and there got an idea, then he felt that we should have a camp like this, 4 days, 5 days, where we can spend time to get a full idea, 1:1, which generally does not get it anywhere else. So we had a camp, first camp in 2013. It was conducted in the shed where we are taking a food, you know, that is the place. This building was not there at the time. Something like 70 of us were staying there. There are hardly two rooms, and one of the rooms, we gave the place to Aya and Amma, Mrs. and Aya. And so all the places were occupied as 70. That is a big number there. And that was his program. None of us got irritated. None of us got tired after. That is the beauty of it. All of us enjoyed. It was a 5-day program. Another important point with this kind of program with Aya is, it is purely 1:1. That means you spend time to understand. His concept is understand. That understanding will take care. Okay? Then what is that understanding? Okay? If that question obviously comes. The simple example is when we start our schooling life, the understanding is given like a table, 2 + 2 = 4. Okay? Once you understand this, then throughout the life it is there, without you remembering, automatically it flows in. So Aya concept is like this. You understand. Then it will take care throughout your life. He spends for giving time to understanding only. So the beauty of this kind of questioning, program is, once he gives an idea, you have got more time to ask any kind of questions. He will answer very quietly, politely, without any bad emotions. That is the beauty of it. People ask all kinds of questions, all kinds of questions. So that is the beauty of it. People definitely get benefit. And those who are in a severe problem like worries, etc., they have got very good of benefits from Ayya's concepts. Really good, they have come out of from his condition. Just I will tell you one case out of this. There is a person there in Bangalore, a woman, say around now 30 plus. She had psychological problems. She even went for cutting his hands. She went up to that stage. Obviously, anybody will take to psychologists. The psychologist, obviously, they give, after a lot of examination, they give list of tablets. They also tell, these tablets you should never skip. This is throughout your life. And at that time, she was not having a child. She was put a condition that you should not bear a child. It was the condition. During this time, she comes to know about Ayya, that he can give a solution, right? So he talks to Saravanan. Maybe he will come, who is the main organizer. She talks to Saravanan. Saravanan discussed over phone only, and she got cured. That is the beauty of it. This concept, he talked over phone. Of course, many a time she would have talked. She is fully cured. Then after, say, 1 year or 2 years afterwards, she goes to the doctor. Then doctor asks the question, why you did not come? Are you taking the medicine? He said, I have stopped your medicine more than a year back. I am all right. You have spoiled my life. That is what she had told. What I am trying to say is, the Ayya concept is able to bring out any people who are psychologically affected. So psychologically problem is very good for this. Understanding is very good. Now, do we need anything? Do we need to practice anything like others? Like say meditation or yoga asanas, this, that and all these things? No, his teaching is not with respect to that. Do we have any slogans to be practiced? Any unknown language? No, it is not there. A simple language, maybe say in Tamil or maybe in English, will try to drive you the concepts. Okay, is it with respect to only Indian people? No, there are a lot of foreign people who got benefited, and his books have been translated in, say, German language, Hebrew, Italian. Even now they are in contact. You can see one of them here. So here the only need we have got is, you would have passed through various courses, various books, various concepts, etc. We are not asking you to give up those concepts. Okay? You still can have. But keep an open mind to receive this concept. So this will help you to acquire. This is the total contents of this course. But I will still repeat, this is for understanding purpose. This concept was developed by him. You can spend your time in asking questions and till you get the end of it. And not only now, say now you are satisfied now, and tomorrow after going to your place, you are still getting the doubt. You can still contact him. Actually, he reserves some, in the day he reserves for some time to answer the question to the people. Almost all of them get connected to him and ask the question, please connect me to Bhagavad Ayya. He says, I am Bhagavad Ayya speaking. That means he talks to you straight. There is no beating around bush and all this. You know, he is not available. Please call me later. All those things are not there. So far as he is free, he will answer to you straight. So that will give you a good understanding, good improvement to your life which will be useful to you. Basically, in short, what you are going to get by understanding this is how to lead a better life. Are we not living a life? Every one of us living, educated, non-educated, we are living a beautiful life. Then what is the question of better and useful, better life? By understanding this, this gives us a doubt. See, we are living a pack of emotions and the works. Our life is pack of this, these two. If that is not balanced, then there is a disturbance always. Here the teaching is given how to live in a balanced condition between these two, which is generally not available anywhere else. Generally it is not available. Because we know we live with emotions, we live with work, we know both of this. Here a equation is given as to how it is to live with. Okay, with this background and understanding, I will invite Bhagavath Ayya for the program.
I welcome all of you to the English Enlightenment Retreat for this year. We conduct English retreat for every year at Thiruvannamalai around this January month. But this year alone, we are conducting this retreat here. We all know the word enlightenment. But we do not know what is the implication around this word. There are many philosophies, many religion around this word enlightenment. Everyone approach enlightenment in their own ways. There are many confusion, many problems around this word. Previously, I was working as an advocate in my native place. Around 30 years before, at that time, there was a temple, some local temple in my custody. And for that, one priest doing pujas was appointed regularly. At one time, he was the regular pujari, the regular priest was on leave, and a temporary person was appointed. He is a wandering monk who was staying in that temple, and he was temporarily appointed as a priest for a time being. And I had some conversation with him. What was his career? What was his job on the spiritual field? He told me that he was leaving from his house right from his age of 15 or 16. From that period onwards, he was searching for enlightenment, searching and searching till this age. But when I was meeting him, he was at his age of 80. But he was still searching what is enlightenment. He has gone many ashrams, many masters, many practices, but still he was searching. And he shed tears, saying that I was unable to know what is enlightenment. Still I am searching. On hearing this, I am not having any pity upon him. Instead of that, quite I was afraid of him because I am also searching the same way. But during that period, I may be around 40 years. But he was 80 years. During my age of 40 years, I am searching, and still from the age of 16 till the age of 80, he was searching for enlightenment. And there are many philosophies. Some philosophies say that you have to do many practices this birth, and some other birth you will get enlightenment. It was postponed like this. So actually, after the enlightenment program, we are having a special confirmation program for the person who has got understand what is enlightenment, and afterwards he may require some confirmation. For that, we are having a separate program for confirmation. And when I want to contact this confirmation program, I search what are the sayings of many masters, many philosophies regarding enlightenment. But nobody has given a clear idea about what is enlightenment. Everybody is having a confusing statement, some vague statement, vague idea that nobody can understand. So that is why we are searching and throughout their life. Now, what is enlightenment? What is the statement of Vedanta scriptures on the line of enlightenment? The knowledge which gives you liberation is known as enlightenment. The knowledge or understanding which gives you liberation, that is known as enlightenment. So they say some knowledge or understanding which creates liberation, that is enlightenment. But in the Vedanta scriptures or spiritual world, comparing with enlightenment, the liberation is considered as the highest thing, and the enlightenment is only a way for liberation. So the liberation is the final goal. For that, enlightenment helps. So we have to understand what is enlightenment, and we have to get enlightenment, then only we can come to liberation. And they have expressed what is enlightenment, what is liberation, in many ways. If we follow that, naturally we will be confused. But is it very hard to know like this? For instance, we can refer the history of the Gautam Buddha. He was also searching for enlightenment for a relief from all his worries and problems. He gone away from his routine life. He renounced his family life. He renounced his kingdom. Everything he gone away. And as a monk, he was practicing something for the attainment of enlightenment. And it was said, two masters taught him how to do meditation and other things. And he also practiced meditation. When he did meditation, he got some good experience. And it was nice and marvelous. But at the same time, even though he got some good experience, very soon he got away from that experience. The experience gone away from him. So he think, anyhow, I have got some experience through some meditation, some practice. If I do the practice seriously, I may have the experience permanently. He will come to a conclusion like this. So he did in practice the meditation very seriously. For 6 years, he did many kind of meditation. He followed many kind of austerities. But he met the same result. Some experience he got and he lost the same experience. So he was quite confused what to do next. And he, at last he come to a desperate condition that he cannot proceed further. Because whatever he was taught, he executed, he had practiced all those things. But in spite of all those severe and arduous practice, he did not get the result. So he sat under a tree in a desperate condition, what to do next. If he has any idea to do something, he will execute it. But now he do not have any idea to execute. Because he has executed all the ideas and he got the same result and he lost the experiences. But he do not know what to do next. But in that desperate condition, unexpectedly he met with some change in his mind. But he do not know what kind of change he has got. It was unexpected. He has not practiced anything. Without his practice, he got something. And find, it was the thing he is searching for that. But he got it unexpectedly, without any practice. And he find in that condition his mind was functioning in a different dimension. And in that dimension, in that functioning of different dimension, there was no problem of his mind. All problems are washed away. And he named that state as Nirvana. He given a name as Nirvana. And he said, I have find out something which is already within me. I have not created this. It is already with me. And today I have found out. It is not for me. It is not only for me. Everybody is having the same thing within themselves. Those who are finding the thing within themselves, they can be free from everything. All problem of his life, they can free from that. What is that? What is the state of Nirvana? What is the state which Buddha has found out? Whether Buddha alone has found out for himself as the first time? What about the other masters? What about the scriptures? Do they not tell anything about that? Actually, everybody is saying the same thing. Everybody has found out the same thing. But they name it in a different way. The scripture says that is mukti, moksha, liberation, awakening. In many ways they name it. Actually, what is the state? What is the quality of that state? What is the different kind of function of Buddha on that time? For example, everybody is interested in the spiritual world only because of their problem in their life. If we do not have any problem in our life, we will not step into the spiritual world. So if we come to the spiritual world, that means we have some problem in our life. So if there is no problem, there is no spiritual world. So basically, we want some freedom from the problem, freedom from the suffering of our mind. We know each and everything of the world will have a life duration. For example, anybody who was born must have died. So what are the things that appear that has to disappear? Everything has a life duration. So in this kind, our psychological problem, psychological emotion will have also a life duration. For example, we may take an example of fear, sorrow, anger. What is the life duration of fear? What is the life duration of anger? There are many, we may see, you may come across many person, he will have sorrow throughout his for years or years together. They may have some sorrow. They may have some fear. So actually, what is the life duration of an emotion? We think if we do not give any solution to the emotion, they will not go away from us. We think like that. We have to drive our emotion from us. We think like that. But actually, the life duration of each and every emotion is only a fraction of a second. So that is the nature of our emotion. But we do not know the quality, the nature of our emotion. That is why we are trying in many ways to separate our emotions. For example, we may come across with the fact of the thunder during the rainy season. We might have come across the lightning, the thunder. And if we know the real fact of the thunder, real fact of the lightning, we have to know the details of that. During the lightning, some flashlight will come first, and after a few seconds later alone, we'll have the noise of the thunder. But no one will be afraid of the lightning, but they will be afraid only of the noise of the thunder. But when we hear the noise of the thunder, actually there is no thunder at all, there is no lightning at all. The lightning is over when the flashlight is over. The noise of the thunder is only some result of the lightning, the after effect, the reaction of the lightning, the reaction of the thunder. Actually, when we hear the noise of the thunder, actually there is no existence of thunder itself. There is no existence of lightning itself. But we are afraid of the thunder, afraid of the noise when it is over. So here, in this way, each and the emotions are in the same way. But we think all emotions are constant and it will go away from us unless we do something against that. So that is the basic problem of ours, each and everybody. Actually, the first and second session alone is the important session. If you are thorough with this first and second session, the other sessions are very supportive only. Not the main session is the first and second session. Somebody might have traveled a lot and might have feel some drowsiness. And if you feel some drowsiness in the morning, we may continue the session in the afternoon itself. But there is no hurry because we are having 4 days and we are having ample time, and we need not be hurry, but we may pick up. But because the first and second session is the very important session, if you are completely understand the first and second session, that is quite enough for the total retreat. And we can question the details of that.
Okay. So mainly about this concept which Aya was talking about, it is not something that we need to just believe and follow. It requires some intense questioning. It is like a discovery process, right? Like for example, how Columbus discovered America, even though America was already existing, but he had to discover that and announce that to the world, right? So similarly, even though Aya is explaining all the concepts, it is not that you just believe in those concepts and just follow. It is something that you need to inquire within yourself, understand that, and it should become your concept or your truth. Then only you will actually see the benefit of that. So it requires intense questioning of his process. Let it be even if you don't agree on the concept, or even if you don't agree on any of his approach, you should be able to bluntly question that. You may not question him directly, or at least you should be able to, at least we should not deceive ourselves that, you know, accept something which we don't want to accept. It should not be like that, right? We should be really open enough and admit that I don't want to accept this, or I'm not able to accept this. So that will actually trigger the questioning process in you. Then only you will be able to understand the entire concept by yourself. Then only you will see that it starts working. So maybe I think that is why Aya must have felt that, you know, it requires that energy and enthusiasm to question and understand. So maybe that's why I thought of, we can have a little interactive session as well. You know, you can also give your views. Just we can talk about maybe what is enlightenment. We can talk about that. Just maybe a tip about to understand what is enlightenment. We can probably think about why do you want enlightenment. I mean, what is the purpose of you at trying to seek enlightenment? If we maybe try to understand that, then you will come to a point and understand what is enlightenment. That's how I think. So maybe anyone, if you want to share your views or if you want to give your comments, we can talk about that. Right? A short introduction should be okay.
I'm Muthulakshmi from Chennai. I've been associated with Aya for the past 7-8 years. So that's it.
Subramani from Viluppuram. ஆனால் நேட்டிவ் வந்து சேலம் அம்மாப்பேட்டை தான். ஒரு 3-4 மாதங்களுக்கு முன்னே தான் ஐயா வந்து யூடியூப் வழியாக அறிமுகமாகி ஒரு ஃப்ளையிங் விசிட் மாதிரி ஒரு முறை வந்து பார்த்துட்டு போனேன். ஏற்கனவே இது வரலாமான்னு கேட்டிருந்தேன். அவர் வந்து ஆங்கிலமாக இருக்குது, தமிழாக இருந்தால் சிறப்பாக இருக்கும், அப்போ சொல்கிறேன்னு சொன்னார். அப்புறம் திடீர்னு நேற்று அவரே ஃபோன் பண்ணி இங்கே வரதாக இருந்தால் வாங்கிறத சொன்னது ஒரு அழைப்பு, ஒரு கிரேட் அழைப்பாக ஃபீல் பண்ணி வந்திருக்கேன்.
ஹாய், ஐ ஆம் சௌமியா ஃப்ரம் பாண்டிச்சேரி. நோ, ஐ ஆம் நாட் ஒர்க்கிங். ஐ எம் ஜஸ்ட் சர்ச் ஆஃப் ரிலாக்ஸிங். தட்ஸ் வை ஐ ஆம் ஹியர்.
Yeah, Deepak Kamath. My name is, I am from Bangalore. I am basically a journalist by profession and a spiritual shopper also. That is not a job, but that is my passion. So I have covered more than 200 spiritual gurus, more than 1,000 techniques, etc., etc. But I feel that I have not reached any conclusion. I am still going through the flow. I met the Bhagavat Aya around 4 months ago by searching in the internet, Living Enlightened Masters. I found two. One, Prashant Acharya in Noida. I have Bhagavat here. I found Prashant Acharya a little bit politically correct, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, bye-bye stuff. I said, this is irritating. This, and I read the book, Don't Delay Enlightenment. It offered a new perspective. And plus, I liked the fact that Bhagavataya had also 40 years he sought. He went to a lot of places. I said, oh, this is like me. You know, I have gone to a lot of places. And even then I came here directly. Nobody was here. I was shocked. Enlightened master and nobody is here. Then he came, he talked to me for 1 hour. Then I, you know, subtly I interrogated, like, because we don't know. He's a new person. But he answered very calmly, quietly. And again, I was shocked. Am I so lucky to find an enlightened master? 1 hour I talked to him and no charge, nothing. So after that, my professor is there. He is also a spiritual shopper. I sent him because he is another very irritating person. For, like he said, for 50 years he has been traveling, meeting people and all that. He stayed here for 2 days. Yeah, very irritating person. And I asked him later, how did you find this guy in Mangalore? So he said, see, that guy is enlightened 100%. By his body language, I am telling you, he is enlightened. Then why did you run away? He said, in 2 days he ran away. He said, I am not going to come here. He said, he's enlightened, but I have doubts about his, process. Anyway, but I got one certificate from him, because that guy will not leave anybody, even Ravi Shankar and all he questioned, he abused them and came away. He's one such person. So from that I understood that, okay, there is a, then I introduced two more persons here. So even they were like, because I believe he is enlightened because of that stability, he has that inner stability. Okay, talking anybody can do, because I've been a journalist, I know people who can talk and talk, that's not an issue. But that inner stability, right, that is something which has impressed me also. Regarding the knowledge and theory, of course anybody can, but that stability, that is something. So I want to be in the presence. Okay, philosophy and all, you know, I am a journalist, I have heard, I have mastered, I can say, because I have read the entire English and Sanskrit dictionary. But that man of integrity, the presence, that can make a difference. That changes, not the talk. That's what I feel. Okay.
Hey, I'm Babulal. I have come from, say, Bangalore. I was leading a normal life. There was no problem. But still, I had a interest, in addition to my normal way of life, on this spirituality. But I never knew where to go and what it is and how to get it. I got an idea, it is only through meditation. So I joined some gurus to undergo the meditation course. I went first course, second course, and things like that. The interesting point out of it is that at the end of the second course, what was given was night around 3 o'clock, you have to do the meditation, which is having a very high sound. Okay, if we do that kind of meditation in the house, everybody will come and beat us. The house in which I was living was a duplex house. All of the people will be living in the first floor. So I used to come to the ground floor and do this meditation. Say, when I started doing, whole family people got afraid that some thief had come into the house making so much of noise. Okay, so that is how I started. Then I read his books also. Even after 1 year or 1.5 years, nothing was coming up. No idea is coming up. At that junction, at that point of time, I got this Ayya's book, Don't Delay Enlightenment, and I was surprised that I was able to get some idea immediately, though not full. Then immediately I bought all the books and then CDs, etc. I read through, then I did not get the full picture of what it is. Fortunately, the first camp took place at this that time, here, in this place, for 5 days. So, I came here, attended the program. I got a better idea than what it was. Then further what happened is, I have collected all its speeches and I have shared with the people every day as a portion of it by around 10 minutes. Then by listening all those things, by the queries which many of us ask, then the refinement has taken place well. So now that I have got a good understanding about it, so I mean that is very helpful to me. I can help to the people who are in dire need. That is the status I am with. So that's why I enjoy this program very much, even though it is a repeat. I come here and I listen the queries and questions and how Ayya reacts to that. The beauty of this Ayya reaction is, for the same question, the answer is not same. It differs. I asked this question to Ayya, how can you give a different answer to different people for the same question? What Ayya says is, the core of the answer is same. We need to give an answer to give an idea to him, depending upon the level of the person. A kind of person may need a kind of answer, and another kind of person may need a different answer. We have to give an answer which gives to him a satisfied information. So that kind of thing which attracts with Ayya. So that is how I enjoy here and continuing here. Okay.
So my name is Mats. That's the Swedish pronunciation of Matthew, you can think if you don't recognize this name. And I'm from Sweden, and this is the third time I'm in India in the winter, looking for connection with the Indian spirituality, you can say. And one of the most important thing, I try to know what kind of awakened masters they are to be in their presence, because that seems to be the best help you can get. So because of this, I'm here now to I met Sri Bhagavat in Tiruvannamalai last year when he got some free satsangs there.
I'm Shekhar. I reside in Chennai. Academically, I'm basically a chemical engineer and specialized in plastics. So that is as far as my education and profession is concerned. On the spiritual aspect, maybe I think from the younger days, first I was attracted by Siddhis, the occult powers and all that. So started reading books about Raja Yoga, Vivekananda's methods, and then several teachers. Then slowly I started understanding these are smaller things. There is something bigger than this. And slowly this thing evolved into a search called, like, what is the purpose of life? Then finally, now I am with this question, who am I? I've been searching for this, trying to get an answer or at least a method through which we should be able to find out. And so many yogic paths, in fact recently, as he was saying, that meditation at 3 o'clock and all that, intense camps, introduction, those things and all we have passed through. But those require all very big serious efforts, and I thought that maybe truth should be much more simpler, or maybe I am lazy, I don't know. I'm trying to find an answer to that. Yeah. So that's how I'm here.
This is Geeta Shekhar from Chennai. Actually, he's much interested in spirituality. I was just a normal... sometimes I feel, actually I'm blessed with good life and everything, comfortable life. I always feel that what is the purpose? I feel bored actually, doing the same routine daily. What is there? Are we born for this? Doing the same routine, what, there is nothing interesting. I feel so. I like doing meditation, I do it. I get a level of calmness when I do meditation, I love. But still, I feel, see, what is there in this life? Till we are going to die, we are going to do the same routine, bound with same duties, responsibilities. So I wanted to know something, so I joined him.
I'm Chandrika from Tanjavur. From childhood, from teenage, the word jnana is a great attraction for me. What is jnana? The jnanis are revered most in India. And whatever places I can't go, so whatever books I came across, I read. And I try to grasp, then whatever we read, one thing I find, our mind jumps before us and he objects. Our mind in ourselves strongly. So the more we read, the objecting mind gets stronger. Then there's an answer with Ramana, I think. Then the essence of Ramana's teaching is, trace back your own mind. There is stuck. How to trace back? Trace back means, I understand it's from what is our present age, evaluating our past, like that I think. Then trace back our own mind means there is stuck. Then they say, oh, for mind calming, that's meditation. But the process of, in the process of meditation also, we get difficulties with the mind, and sometimes we get success in meditation and the mind slowly hides, then it comes before us. And then finally, it's like a conclusion, I think. What's more important than jnana is how to be peace with ourselves first. We are we are putting some of our portion in the small I, capital I, and the capital SELF, like that we are moving around. Then how to be in peace with ourselves? There comes the simplest clear teaching of Aya. Don't trouble yourself with your own mind. I think that's the essence of Aya's teaching. Let it flow. Then I think it's a kind of junction for us. But as human beings, all the faults are always with us. They call it the samskaras, padivugal. So we have to always have a thought or reading or to be in the presence of our master, whomsoever we chose us to. He gives us peace. And this 4 days gives us the best chance for us. And thank you for all.
I am Gunalan from Coimbatore. I was first read the book of Don't Delay Enlightenment, that is in Tamil, it is Jnana Vidudalai. At the end of the completion of that book, I come to know my entire mind has just stopped. I felt like a hollow man. That time my son used to see the movie Hollow Man. The only skeleton is there, nothing inside the head. Such a feeling I had it those days. That was very, very long. It was going on like that. I cannot think or anything at all, just a hollow. After reading subsequent book, everything, I come to know there is no I. It is only coming and going, just like passing clouds. When there is no I, there is no question of possessiveness, my or mine or ours, yours, like that. Then everything is going, flowing, every emotion, feeling, sensation comes spontaneously. It is not our efforts. I understood it. So, I have a sensation of to take whatever you need, outcome of feelings or sensations. Just like in Tamil, there is a proverb, odra mata veratikittu pogada. When the flow of mind, outcome is flowing, we are only going behind them and thinking like that. So, I have come to a peaceful state now. I am very happy and thankful to Aya, Sri Bhagavat.
My name is Surabhi. I am from Delhi. I had come here about 2 years ago, and a Vipassana teacher told me about Sri Bhagavataya, and of course this place is very calming and it is very very still actually, but Anand's question, which was why do we need enlightenment or this kind of an inquiry, this is something that I haven't really done. Why do I need it? Maybe I already have it and I don't realize it. So this time I have come to actually inquire.
As already told by Anand, we are searching for enlightenment. Maybe more clarity will come when we know why we are behind it. So that's why this question is put. This will help in inquiry and that will ultimately lead to the result. So, sir, neenga vandu inga vandirkeenga appdin sonna enna kaaranathukaga தேடி வந்திருக்கீங்க அப்படின்னு சொல்லிட்டு நீங்கள் ஷேர் பண்ணலாம். அதுதான்
கேட்குறேன். இது தமிழில் தான் பேச முடியுங்க. சிறு வயதுலேருந்தே இதை பற்றி தேடிட்டு இருந்தாலுமே காலகாலமாக பெரியவங்க சொல்கிறது எதுவுமே இன்னும் வந்து மெட்டீரியலைஸ் ஆகலை, அதாவது சமுதாயத்தில் நடைமுறையாக வரல. 2500 ஆண்டுக்கு முன்னே புத்தன் சொல்லிட்டு போனார், ஆசைய துன்பத்துக்கு காரணம்ட்டு அவர் கண்டுபிடிச்சு சொல்லிட்டார். அது மெட்டீரியலைஸ் ஆகலை, அது ஏன் ப்ராக்டிக்கலாக வரல அப்படிங்கிறது ஒரு இந்த மாதிரி காலகாலமாக வள்ளுவர் உட்பட நிறைய பேர் நிறைய உண்மைகள் சொல்லிட்டு போகிறாங்க, ஆனால் எதுவுமே வந்து வாழ்க்கையில் வந்து ஒரு பாகமாக ஆகலை நமக்கு. அந்த அவங்க சொன்னது இன்னும் வந்து சமுதாய நிகழ்வாக ஆகலை. அதனால் நான் பல்வேறு இடத்துக்கு போயிட்டு வந்தாலும் இது ஒரு என்கொயரி மைண்டாக தான் போயிட்டு இருந்தேன்னு சொல்லி நான் சொந்த வாழ்க்கையில் அமுல்படுத்துகிற மாதிரி ஒரு நிலைக்கு ஆளாகலை நான். ஏன்னா எதுவுமே வந்து நடக்கலை. ஒரு புத்தனுக்கு பிறகு இன்னொரு புத்தன் தோன்றலை, ஒரு வள்ளுவனுக்கு பிறகு இன்னொரு வள்ளுவன் தோன்றலை, இந்த மாதிரி இருந்துகிட்ருக்கேன். அப்புறம் தான் வந்து இதுக்கெல்லாமே இவங்க சொல்கிற இதுக்கெல்லாம் ஒரு மெட்டீரியல் பேஸ் இல்லை போல் இருக்குது அப்படின்னு நினச்சிட்டு இருந்தேன். நான் வள்ளுவர்களில் மட்டும்தான் ஒரு மெட்டீரியல் பேஸ் இருக்கிறத நான் ஃபீல் பண்ணிகிட்டு இருப்பேன். நான் அவர் சொன்னது மட்டும் பார்த்தாக்க எல்லாமே இயற்கையில் என்ன இருக்கோ அதை அப்படியே வந்து ஒரு இது பண்ணியிருக்கிறார், வாழ்க்கைக்கு வந்து பொறுத்திருக்கிறார். இயற்கையில் இல்லாததை வாழ்க்கையில் அமல்படுத்த முடியாத எந்த ஒரு கான்செப்டுமே வள்ளுவத்தில் இல்லை, ஊழ்வனையிலேருந்து பிறவியிலேருந்து எதுவுமே. அதனால் அதை மட்டுமே மீண்டும் மீண்டும் சிந்திச்சுட்டு இருப்பேன். இப்போ ஐயாவை வந்து பார்த்து இவருடைய இது சில யூடியூப்லாம் கேட்கும்போது இவர் ரொம்ப நெருக்கமாக வள்ளுவருக்கு நெருக்கமாக இருக்கிற மாதிரி எனக்கு ஒரு ஃபீல் வந்தது. ஆனால் ஐயா நேரடியாக வள்ளுவருக்கு வந்து அட்ரிபியூட் பண்ணலை எதையுமே, யாரும் பண்ணவும் தேவையில்லை. அவங்க வந்து இயற்கையில் என்ன இருக்கோ அது சமுதாயத்தில் அது எப்படி செயல்படுதோ அதை பார்த்து தான் எசன்ஸாக எடுத்து சொல்கிறாங்க. அந்த மாதிரி இது ஒரு ரிலேட்டிவாக இருக்கிறதுனால ஒரு ஆர்வம். இது வந்து தனியாகவும் பயிற்சி பண்ண வேண்டியதில்லைன்னு தெளிவாக சொல்கிறாரு. அது நம்ம வாழ்க்கையில் ஒரு பாகமாக இருக்குது, அங்கமாக இருக்குது, அதை ஏற்றுங்க. செயல்படுறது மட்டும் மெட்டீரியலாக, செயல்பாட்டுக்குன்னு வரும் பொழுது இயற்கை நீதி, சமூக நீதி, உலக தர்மத்தை கடைபிடிச்சிங்க அப்படின்னு சொல்கிறாரு. அது ஒரு அப்பீலிங்காக இருந்தது. அது சமயம் மேலும் மேலும் வந்து கொஞ்சம் தெளிவடைஞ்சிக்கிறதுக்காகவும் மேலும் மேலும் அதை ரிப்பீட் ஆக்கிறதுக்காகவும் வந்தேன்.
Got the question, but I hate to speak in mic, that's why. It's okay, okay. I will keep it short and sweet. I'm here to know enlightenment because I just was just wandering and following the fake people with fake promises. I just want to break it out. And I want to feel myself and I want to live with myself only. That that's something to be induced to feel and something has to be there to move on. That's why I came here with not too much of questions, just few questions with I have personally I want to ask few questions with Aya. So it will help. Seems that's why I came here.
Basically, enlightenment is just a word, but I feel I needed to know myself. I mean, this is not a theory that I'm speaking. I still remember when I was 3 years old, I used to sit under the table so that nobody can recognize me. Nobody can know where I am. Then I used to think, where I have come from? I mean, I still remember that. After that, the parents used to drag me, then they used to put me into school. So the same thought came at the age of 17. Who am I? Where am I? That thought. After that, I went into astrology just to know who am I. The horoscope I saw, it had Sannyas Yoga in the horoscope. I have Sannyas Yoga in my horoscope. I was just thinking. I asked many people. They said, why are you bothered? You eat, drink, have fun. There were two sannyasis in my family. One was in Ramakrishna Mission and all. So I used to go there. Even there I used to get confused. They used to complicate things. You serve humanity, you don't need that and all. But deeper, that was still there. So I found a job, good job, money, everything I had, enjoyment. But this thing was eating me. I don't know who I am. What is my requirement? Is it just eating, drinking, having fun? Is this life? So then I read one Osho's line, man's greatest misery is that he does not know himself. I realized I might be a great journalist. Many people, I have power, I have money, everything, but I still don't know who I am. I just wanted to solve that. And nobody has been able to, even I don't know who I am, nobody has been able to convince me as to who I am. So that question mark is still there. But now I am not, I am quite saturated in the sense, I have seen everything. I know Modi personally, you know, the power center, the money center, everything I have seen. But this question is still there. Who is this, this body-mind structure? I have read so many philosophies. But that ultimate who am I, that question is still there. That question mark still remains. Okay, I am a man of the head. I am not a very hearty person. Even then I got married and I am still in family just like that. But that question, so I feel that till that question disappears, that is my only passion now. I don't have any other because I have seen life in all varieties. I have fought, I have lived everything. But that question mark, that is, for that to resolve, you call it enlightenment, you call it any other name, that question mark should disappear. It is still there. Yeah, that's it.
So I don't have a new answer for this question today, but when I've thought about this before, I got some kind of stable orientation in this, and it's very much like what you, the woman here, was saying, I think. And it is that there will always be illusions in life, but I want to know when something is an illusion, I want to know that it is an illusion. So I'm not, you know, like putting my weight. If this chair was an illusion, it would be bad to trust it to sit. So like that, I and because of this, you know, self-inquiry, I can see my own inner illusions. And now I could start speak and never finish, so I leave it at this.
Yeah, my idea is very similar to what Deepak is saying. It's like, who I am basically, why I am here. The answer, the enlightenment should be something which does not allow me to raise any question for me. There is no more questions for me. So that is the thing which I want to get as a, I mean, I think enlightenment is something which can give that. Or I don't know how to express. I can just say that no questions should be there in me afterwards.
In life. Whatever relations or identification we attach with us, at some point or sometime, got severed. And slowly we accumulate the pains, if you think deeply. First we give meaning to some things, or some relations, or some attachments. Then slowly, as we human as we are, we need something permanent. The search permanency. So by tradition, we are introduced to God, then to jnanis, then to eternity and enlightenment. And all are saying the ultimate is enlightenment. But enlightenment seems like a spaceship, rocket or something very higher. They say enlightenment is ultimate, but the ways, the goal, is very high. And the Orient philosophy says, I read it from Osho, what is most difficult is to be an ordinary man. That is the essence. That, again, we are on the bridge. Enlightenment, they say. Again, most difficult is an ordinary man. To be an ordinary man, you are liberated. Again, we are on the bridge. And what we need is the thinking, let's for ourselves, our thinking is our mother tongue, and we have a talking mother tongue. I feel Aya connects both for us, fortunately as well for Tamilians, in meaning ways for others also, the simplest thinking and simplest language. At last, if we feel at rest with ourselves, and yet understanding by reading itself, I can't call for myself enlightenment. Still, the presence of Guru will bless on us the enlightenment.
Okay, thank you all. Of course, I mean, there is nothing, it's not to judge somebody is wrong or right, that's not the purpose. The intention here is to start questioning and getting into ourselves, that's the whole idea. Maybe I'll give my views also, it may help you to question more and deep dive. So my view is enlightenment, I mean, we should not connect this with any religious concepts or God or, you know, any other gurus. We don't need to connect all this. Enlightenment is something which is required for our day-to-day life, to solve our day-to-day life problems. If that is not solved, all this is not going to help, right? Because you're here for 3 days. After that, we go back to our daily life. And if our daily life problems are not solved, what is the use of it, right? So maybe I'll give you an example, what happens and how. Assume you're buying a new car, right? So you're going to a showroom and buying a new car and you parked it in front of your house. And so when you buy a new car, of course, you definitely, it will trigger some happiness inside you, right? So and then you come and park your car outside your house, maybe because of some violence or some reason, somebody breaks the glass, right? So obviously it is your car, you will feel that pain or sorrow, right? So if you see, actually, again, when you were few minutes back, when, you know, it was in the showroom, when you bought the car, you were happy. And then when something happened, you felt the pain. So because you started attaching that to yourself, right? Now it has become my car. Psychologically, now it has attached to that identity. It is my car. So anything which hurts my identity or my me, definitely it hurts me. So that's how it happened, right? But if you see this, if you divide this into two aspects. So one is the external part of it, like the glass, is somebody has broken the glass of your car. So the external aspect is relatively simple and easy to handle, actually. It is because we don't know we are kind of confused, where is the problem and what to do. So that's why we are kind of struggling to handle. Otherwise, if you see the external aspect, if the glass is broken, you have only probably 3-4 things to handle, that's all. Even if you don't know what to do, you can always ask your friend, relative, or any other senior guys. They can give you advice on how to handle that. May either file a police complaint or do an insurance claim or just pay the money and get rid of it. So all that, right? So that is practically, that is a simpler aspect. But the problem here is the pain it creates, right? So that is what we are not able to handle, because we don't know, we just keep haphazardly looking for solutions. Suppose, you know, if it is inside, we are looking for solutions outside, you're trying to correct something outside, or if the problem is outside, then you're busy focusing inside, struggling with our mind, how to forego this pain, how to get rid of this sorrow, a lot of things, right? So we are kind of confused between here and there, so we keep haphazardly looking for solution. We don't know, you know, what to do. So basically, so the problem is we don't know how to handle this instrument of both body and mind. Right, so that is where the whole problem starts. Once we understand how to handle this body and mind, then you'll be able to handle it better. You'll know exactly how it works. So then you can use however we want it to use, however we want to apply this in our daily life, we can use it. So, which means the understanding of what can be done with my mind, what cannot be done, how to act in the external world, what are the options we have. If you understand these two aspects clearly, then you'll be able to handle it better. So that is what will help in solving your day-to-day problems. And that is what we can call as enlightenment. Because once you understand this whole thing and how to handle these instruments, then you'll be able to handle it better, right? Once you know how to drive a car, then you know when to stop, when to apply brake, when to press the accelerator and all that. You don't need to worry about, because if you don't know anything, if you just keep driving, you may hit somewhere. So that is exactly the problem we have. That is why we are not able to handle ourselves better. So maybe it may help you trigger, you know, start thinking on these lines of course, some people were talking about what is enlightenment. The question was, why do you want enlightenment? So that you can start thinking about it. Because, for example, as I think she was saying, some people, if they are naturally in a take it easy mode, you know, life, take the life easy mode, then they may not actually need enlightenment, because they're already kind of taking things easy. So there is nothing, as he said, there is no concept that of enlightenment that we need to attain to. If you're already kind of free and happy, it is not needed. It's as simple as that. Only if you are in a problem and if you don't know how to handle, to come out of that, you need some knowledge or some kind of thing which will help you come out of those problems. So that is the whole purpose of it. So enlightenment is something which will help you. So if you have some problems, then you need to come out of it. That is why you need enlightenment. Otherwise, you don't need anything. For example, if a child doesn't worry about any of these things, whether he is happy or, you know, worried, sorrow, whatever it is, he doesn't worry about all these things. It may be there for a moment, next moment he is happy. So he doesn't need any enlightenment. He is not seeking for any such solutions, right? So only when there is a problem, you will seek for a solution. So my view is enlightenment is required only if you have a problem to solve. So you can probably think more on these lines and inquire this within yourself. That's the whole idea of this.
Yeah, as Anand said, we have to find why we are seeking enlightenment. Like, there are a lot of people in the world, many are into materialistic pursuits. Only a few portion is behind spirituality. So we think spirituality is a higher seeking, whereas material is a lower seeking. But when we come and address why the seeking happens, everything is for end of suffering, right? Everybody might have suffered in life. Otherwise, there is no point in going behind something. If the suffering is for like food and dress and all those things, people will end up in getting all those things by working or studying everything. But then ultimately they'll find either through death of the near and dear ones or through disease or something which for which they have a strong attachment, they would have got a negative result, and for that their mind might be suffering a lot. So all the searches to drop this suffering. So that is the core root cause behind search. That I think everyone would agree. In whatever language we speak, whatever seeking is there, it is in the form of desire. And the desire is, so when he says, I want to know myself, then he says, I'm happy with the materialistic thing. I've enjoyed everything. But still, there is something in me that is putting the question. So anything that is giving a question means the mind is restless. So that is where we want to end. That is where the seeker also drops. So when we can just bring the whole search into the psychological point, that would be much easier. Otherwise, as Anand pointed out, we started with the search for an ending of suffering, but then in the process we got so many concepts. Like from Aya said, Thiruvalluvar has said so many things, Ramana has said, everybody has said. So only in the search for end of suffering we have gathered all those concepts. And those concepts now are ruling the mind. And we have dropped why we started searching. So, okay, fine. Had it helped in any way to end the suffering, or had it increased the suffering by seeking more? No, I don't know who I am. Ramana has talked so much. Osho has given so many things. People have given so many paths. But I'm not able to find out. So that is where. So instead of resting, the mind is, in fact, it is in a roller coaster movement like that. So if we are able to fix where the root of the problem is, then it is much easier to draw the solution also. Like they used to say earlier, there an example was given, like in a cycle tube, if there is a puncture, there is no special instrument in those days. So the mechanic will exactly know the place where the puncture is. Otherwise, he would be keeping on searching for sorting it out. So when he knows where exactly the puncture is, the solution is immediate. But instead of that, if he keeps on searching somewhere, then it takes a long time. So that is why let us see whether we are agreeing on this point, that suffering is there in the mind, and that is where the suffering is in the form of desires or questioning or anything. So can we all agree on that? That's where we can just put all the things into one place, and from there we can go. Anything, whatever you call, the names are different, but if you analyze, restlessness is a synonym for suffering. If you say desire, that is again a synonym for suffering. You can just go through it, you can see for yourself. If there is no desire, there is no restlessness. So whenever it comes, that is what. So whenever there is a restlessness, there is suffering. Whenever there is seeking, so whenever there are questions, then again the mind is restless. So anything and everything, no? When there is a question, the mind is restless. We want to get rid of that. But in the process, we get caught in concepts, bigger concepts. We think, oh, they have written that, the whole world is praising them. So why can't we get it? And the mind gets lost. So we have to exactly know the root of the problem is in seeking. The mind, when it seeks, then it is completely restless, however much it attains, materially or even psychologically. The seeking mind is the root of all the problem. So maybe you can think it over for a few minutes and you can come to a conclusion for yourself. So you called it restlessness, she called it in a different way, he told something. So can you all just fix that? It's all mind seeking, and that is where the problem is. So shall we do that introspection?
Point was actually, she said, rightly said, if we keep looking at gurus and look at all these concepts of enlightenment, liberation, all these things, it is only a theoretical message, right? Unless we know, we discover it within us, we will not come to know. All these will become concepts and theories. We'll keep adding so many theories from so many gurus. So that was my point. Instead of, so that will not help unless, that's why I said, we can keep aside all those concepts and start fresh. Why do I want, first of all these enlightenment? I don't even know the word enlightenment. What is my problem? What do I want to solve? If you don't want enlightenment, you can just be happy as it is. No, it is not mandatory, right? So if you take that path, then you will actually understand what is your mind saying. I mean, you will start listening to your own voice, right? Then it will come out and say, what do you actually want? So then it will be easier to, because then you will drop all the false concepts and whatever is theory, you will drop all that aside, you will keep all that aside, you will straight go, you know, take your route, what is your mind looking for, or what do you want to? So it will be easier to, you know, attach, and easier to, you know, reach the end state. So that was my point, so that you can keep these all these aside. Yeah.